Listen, everybody, I said it's time for church. We got to gather up, everybody. Gather up. Put your electronics down, please. Put them down. Thank you. Put them down. You know what I mean? Like, it's time for church. Oh, hey, everybody. Welcome to GV Christian Center. I'm Pastor Becca. Just over here getting ready for church, as I'm sure you are. Quarantine's going fine for us. It's going fine. Everything's fine. We're all fine. Everything's fine. All right, we're going to get into church this morning. The good news is you can be in your jammies. Nobody has to be perfectly ready, but we do ask that you find a place, find a space in your home, prepare your hearts, and get ready for what God's going to do this morning. Guys, I sit down. All right, here we go. I'm going to go pull myself together. More coffee, please. Hope your coffee pots are full and ready this morning. I'm gonna go get ready.
Welcome to GV Christian Online. We are so grateful that you are gathered together in your living rooms or your kitchens or your bedrooms or wherever you are in worship today. We are so grateful that you are with us. We are gonna worship God together. We're gonna worship God no matter what. He deserves our praise, doesn't he? He deserves our worship, our highest praise, and we're gonna give him that this day. We are so grateful for who you are, Jesus. Come on, let's sing this chorus together.
Holy, holy, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy.
Lord, we are here to worship you today. We're here to give you our best praise. We're here to give you our best worship.
Yes.
How we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amazing grace.
worthy is the Lamb. Sing it. Worship and our highest praise.
Hallelujah.
Let's join in a word of prayer together. Jesus, thank you for all that you have done for us. And as we celebrate your journey to Calvary today, Lord, it is all about your willingness to be obedient to the Father, even to death. And you said that you laid your life down willingly. And today, God, we want to celebrate that. We want to celebrate that you loved humankind enough to first send your son and then for your son to live a perfect life and willing to die a death that was mine. God, thank you for that. We worship you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus, we worship you. Jesus.
Raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than my unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My
I'm gonna sing. Let's join together.
Hallelujah, with everything inside. Thank you. to your heart. Lead me to your heart. Lead me to your heart.
What an incredible time we've had this morning worshiping together as a church. We cannot wait to be back together with you. In a moment, we're going to get into the word together, but just before we do, typically when we gather physically, we always take a few moments to worship and our giving together. And God said we are to do that regularly according to our income. We are not able to worship in our giving right now because we are not together physically. So our giving has moved online. And so many of you have been doing that already. Some have been mailing your giving into the church office during these unusual times, and we want to say thank you for your faithfulness. For those of you who call GB Christian Center your home, on the screen below, there's a place where you can go and find options that are listed of how you can give so that the work of Christ can continue through your church. For some of you who have carried our church in the past with your giving, and you are unable to give as freely as you have, we want you to be released of any guilt, because God, the Bible says that our giving is in proportion to our income. You know, this May, we are approaching 38 years as a church when we opened our doors 38 years ago. And there's been so many who have given in the past who help GV Christian Center to be the church, not only to our people, but to our community as well. And if you are new here to GV Christian Center and you call GV Christian your church home and you have not yet stepped into the journey and adventure of giving, we want to encourage you to fill the gap of those who are unable to do so right now, just as so many before us over these 38 years have done so. We want to continue to be the church, not only to you, but to also our community, and we're working together to do that. Thank you for helping us to be a generous church. We're so grateful to you. We're thankful for your faithfulness. Let's continue to worship together in our giving this morning.
So today, God, we are so thankful that we can worship in spirit and in truth to honor you for going to the cross for us, for providing a way of escape of sin, death, and the grave. You provided the way out. So today, Father, we are so grateful. We are so grateful for who you are and for what you've done for us. What other appropriate response is there but just laying down our life is worship? And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray and we worship. And everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you.
What an incredible time of worship. I don't know about you, but I'm so incredibly grateful for the cross and what Christ has done for all of us. This morning, as we gather together online and we're bringing church right to you into your home, we're so grateful that we can worship together and enter into the Spirit of Jesus together. Thank you, Lord, for your anointing this morning. Are you ready to get into the Word? We're continuing our journey on the road to Calvary this morning. I hope that you're ready. I hope that your hearts are set in the right place to hear from God's Word this morning. Let's get into it.
Welcome, everyone, and we're bringing church to you. What an awesome time we've had already, and our times together singing and worshiping together, connecting with you online during the services, and many of you have been connecting, and we love to connect with you during worship live. We've just enjoyed, some of you go on YouTube and you're not able to do that, and that's fine, YouTube or whatever means. Some have said through Apple TV and our app that's downloadable there. But for those of you that have joined, particularly through our GV Christian Center live broadcast or Facebook, that's just been fun to interact with you and to say we're praying for you and welcome to church online. And so we just love that you're joining with us. And we love to see some of the pictures of you worshiping. And so be sure to send those to us, would you? Because we just love to see you. It just keeps us connected with each other. And so we love that. If you're new to GV Christian, welcome. And you're about to see what God's love can do for you in ways that you cannot imagine. And we're going to see some principles from God's Word that never change in a world that is constantly changing and shifting. The Bible says God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So we're going to be looking at the Word together. And if you want to turn in your paper Bibles or scroll in your devices to Matthew chapter 26, we're going to get there in just a little bit. But I'm standing before you, as you can see, before our prayer wall. And I've loved seeing some of you come up and put some of your prayer requests here in the wall. And I've absolutely loved that. And so we've just been, and where's my prayer request? Here it is. And so I filled out mine just a few moments ago, and I love seeing this. We pray over these, and we are thankful for what God is doing in your life. We pray over these prayer requests, and you can come up here anytime, 24/7, and put your prayer request in this wall. Because we believe in prayer. And this is what the enemy wants to do. Last week, I talked about this, and the enemy wants to instill such fear in your life that it takes away any idea that God can intervene in your life and change your situation and change the situation in the world that we're facing. We saw that Daniel, he prayed 21 days. And so we're praying and we're fasting and we're believing and knowing that God changes things. I am praying that God just lifts this from off of our nation and around the world. So join with me, would you? You and your families, if you're alone, join with me. If you're with other people in your family at home or wherever you're watching and tuning in online, let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you that prayer does change things. And you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we ask for a miracle, whether through medicine or through a miracle that you provide. We pray for our leadership from our president on down, that you would just move among them as they're making very tough decisions here in our state, in every state across our nation, where we find our loved ones and our family members spread out and from around the world. So we thank you and praise you for healing, for a miracle, through whatever means you choose. And we ask you to lift this and heal our family members that have contracted this infectious disease. We thank you and praise you that you're still the God of miracles, and we will keep praying, fasting, and believing in you. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. You know, fear does not have to be pandemic. In fact, today we're going to see how Jesus overcame fear to bring us his power over fear. And just before we get into that, you know, so many of you have asked, and so far some of you have done so. You would say this, you know, God has blessed me so much that I want to give above and beyond my regular giving. How can I do that? And those of you who are still working or your income has not been impacted, and I want to thank you because some of you have gone above and beyond your regular giving. Some of you have gone above and beyond the 10% in giving because your income has not been impacted, and I cannot thank you enough. And many of you have been bringing in non-perishables to the church, and that's happening here Monday through Friday between 10 and 1 o'clock. You can bring those, and those continue to be distributed among those that have some tremendous needs. And it's touching to see people come up. And literally hundreds right here in our own community have been helped because of your generosity. And you know what? And I know this because Meg and I have been in this spot where it can really be difficult, because I can be really proudful. It can really be difficult to set aside your pride and say, you know what? I need some help and to receive. And so some of you are in that situation, and you've never been in that position before, but this is a time, isn't it, to just kind of set our pride aside and just seek help when we need it, whether it's emotionally, spiritually, physically. And our church, your church, is here to help you in every way possible. So thank you. I cannot say thank you enough for being the church of Jesus Christ. And I love what some of you are doing. It's very humbling. And I love this verse. You're doing what James said as Jesus spoke through James, his half-brother, to the church. He said, what good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say that you have faith but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see your brother or sister who has no food or clothing and you say, goodbye, have a good day, stay warm and eat well, but then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces good deeds. It is dead and useless. Now, someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds, but I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by good deeds. I love the Word of God and how it puts it. You know, it's times like these, or at least it should do this in times like these, to consider what is most important in life. Things that we can count on and things that we can't count on. Things that we can hold on to and things that you and I can trust. And what are the things that are trustworthy in your life and mine, and what we can't base our lives on? Hope, real hope in Jesus, moves us from just wishing that things were better and wishing and hoping for a brighter future to a future that we can know in Jesus Christ is secure and it's solid. We have a solid hope in Jesus Christ. So we wish for and we hope for a lot of things, don't we? We wish and we hope that this virus would just go away or die, or that we hope or wish that a cure would be found, and we wish for the economy to kickstart again. And I'm with you on all of these things, and we hope to see and to hug our loved ones again, and these things will come, and we hope to be with our church family again. Oh, we can't wait for that. We miss you so much, and we don't know when all of those things are going to happen. And so we're praying for all of these things to happen. That's where our real hope and real faith comes in hand. But in Jesus, we can know for certain of what we have. Listen to this verse. This is how we know what love is. Not wish for, not hope that it's like this. We can know. And I love this. 1 John 3. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And as we head into this Easter week, as we remember what Jesus did for us, as we're about to celebrate Resurrection Day, And we're going to do it online, but I'm excited about what we have planned for you. You're going to want to invite your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers, if you're connecting with them, to invite us online for Resurrection Day next weekend. But this is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in His presence. It's amazing the rest that we have in the presence of God and what we can know for certain. Well, today we continue the series called The Road to Jerusalem, and this weekend with The Road to Calvary. It is amazing what happened on the road to Calvary in that final week, in the last few days, even the last few hours of Jesus' life as it was before the resurrection. The first Easter, Resurrection Day, was just around the corner. And Jesus knew that victory was just a few hours away. But before that, Jesus knew that He had to go through the cross to get there. He knew that victory was just within reach. But He knew that His mission that He had come to accomplish had to take place first. This road trip through Calvary would be a horrible one. But it's amazing the heart and the spirit and the attitude of our Savior, your Savior and mine, Jesus. It says this, for the joy, Hebrews 2:12, and these references are all in your note sheet. For the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Oh, I love that. For the joy set before Him. There's joy that God has set before you, and He has set before me. But first, the road to Calvary. Jesus is praying. And on the road to Calvary, He stops at a garden called Gethsemane. And we're going to read from it here in Matthew 26 in just a moment. But He stops with some of His closest friends. They had become His closest friends. Now, just 11 of them. One had betrayed Him. Gethsemane. The word means an oil press where there are olive groves. Meg and I had the privilege of being there, where these olive trees are thousands of years old now. It's hard to believe. But it's a place where these olives would be pressed and then turned into olive oil. And as Jesus begins to pray in the garden, He takes three of His closest friends further into the garden. Peter and two brothers, James and John. And He tells them, would you keep watch with me? Would you pray with me? I am completely overwhelmed, Jesus said, with sorrow and hurt. And in the midst of it, He desires to be with His closest friends. He wants to be with them, and He wants them with Him. So He said, would you please pray with me? And Jesus said He is just so consumed with sorrow, even to the point of death. So He goes and He prays, and I want to read this to you. It says this in verse 40. Read with me. So Jesus goes and He prays, and then it says, then He returned to His disciples, and He found them sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter, watch and pray so that you'll not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Boy, I've had so many times when my flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. How about you? So Jesus says to Peter, just come on, guys. What are you doing sleeping? I've asked you to just spend just a few moments with me to watch, be on the alert, to pray. Jesus had done everything He could do to love on these guys. He had healed their family members. He had been with them for 3 years, His closest friends, and now, in the deepest point of His hurt and of His pain, He just needed His friends. He just wanted them to be with Him. But Jesus, in this moment and in this hour, was all alone. Jesus steps away and He prays a second time. And in the second prayer, as the first one, he said, please, God, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. And then he returns to lean on and to find support from his closest friends. But this is what it says. Jesus returned and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more, and he prayed a third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners by one of his closest friends. Rise, let's go. Look, my betrayer is approaching. He sees Judas on the way with a group of soldiers. Jesus had to do this alone. He was the only one worthy. No one else could do it. No one else could help him, because no one else was worthy to do so, endure the cross. And by the time Jesus got up from his knees, and at times being flat on his face before God, by the time he got up, he had a steely resolve. I'm ready. But before that point on the road to Calvary and in the process, he felt alone and he was isolated. You don't have to be alone to be lonely. Some of you are lonely. People can be married and lonely. Students can be surrounded by students and be lonely. You can be surrounded by coworkers and be lonely. You can be surrounded by all kinds of people, but you can be lonely. And on the road to Calvary, there are two great lessons that we see in the last week and in the final few hours of Jesus' life. Here's the first lesson. It's the power of isolation plus the power of Jesus. The power of isolation plus the power of Jesus. Jesus was all alone in the garden. Can you keep watch with me for 1 hour? And when Jesus, just before he breathed his last on the last breath on the cross, he proclaimed these words out of the depth of his soul, out of which you and I will never, ever be able to begin to fathom or understand. And he says this, he says, my God, why have you of all people, why have you forsaken me? For the first time ever in the history of eternity, God the Son was separated from God the Father. Jesus faced the full definition and description of hell. Alone, isolated, even devoid of the love and the presence of God, completely isolated. And you've heard the phrase, it's lonely at the top, haven't you? Why? Because no one really understands the burdens or the full scope of what one sees or often knows at the top. You can't get any higher of a top, can you, than Jesus, God in the flesh, God the Son. And you know what he did in his isolation? He overcame hell, and he overcame the infection of loneliness. And he did so that you and I would never have to be alone again. The power of isolation plus the power of Jesus. Jesus knows that some of you are desperately lonely. He overcame it so that you could always know these words from Jesus. I will never leave you, and I will never, ever forsake you. I will be with you until the end of the world. That's the promise that you and I have. And Jesus conquered isolation and loneliness, and he conquered evil and the infection of loneliness by what he did on the cross. And loneliness. Loneliness causes people to be so empty and to be unwanted. And people who are lonely, they crave human contact. And some of you are craving human connection and contact. Jesus got that. Can't you wait with me just for 1 hour? Just 1 hour. I want to connect with you. I need your help. But he faced isolation alone and he overcame it. In fact, some of you might even take that irritating coworker right now because it'd be better than nothing. But a person in a state of mind when it comes to being desperately lonely, it makes it even more difficult for them to form connections with other people. Do you know that researchers, these are people that are a lot smarter than I am, and every research across the board has found that loneliness is just as lethal to your health as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. And God help the person who's lonely and smoking 15 cigarettes a day. How can there be power in isolation plus Jesus? Here's why. Because isolation brings some of the greatest moments of clarity and God's presence. It's amazing. I do not know of one person in the Bible that was greatly used by God that did not go through a period of isolation and loneliness, but they turned it into connecting with a God who promised, I will never leave you or forsake you. And you know what I believe? That you are something special in the eyes of God, our loving Heavenly Father, if you're isolated and feeling alone as a Jesus follower, because Jesus wants to partner with you to accomplish great things. There are times when so many in the Bible were just alone and they wondered if God knew that they were even around. God, do you even know my prayers? Are they going anywhere to you? They wondered if anybody cared if they were alive or if they were dead. Does anyone care? Is there someone who can take away my isolation and my loneliness? Abraham, can you imagine the loneliness? For those of you familiar with the story, God gave Abraham a command. I want you to take your only son Isaac. After God had promised, there will be more connections and there will be more people not isolated because I'm about to form and create a nation out of you, Abraham. Can you imagine? Right out of you this will come. Can you imagine the loneliness and the isolation that Abraham felt as he was walking up that mountain? Am I supposed to be obedient to God or have my son? What do I do? In those times of decisions, we can be and feel so isolated and so all alone. Would there be any more of a lonely time when you have to make some of the toughest decisions that you've ever made in your life? Moses spent two 40-year periods in the wilderness, all alone at times. At times, even his own family turned on him. And the people that he had so loved, they turned on him and they were ready to stone him. What a lonely spot. David's own son, a guy by the name of Absalom, had overturned David's throne and had run. David was a fugitive and had to run for his life. And so many of the Psalms, which are lyrics to songs that speak of God's presence when David was all alone, when his son and so many had turned against him. David at one point said this when he was all alone. He said, in God alone my soul finds rest. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. I will never be shaken. In his isolation, he turned to God and God met him in a powerful way. As a Jesus follower, do you remember having seasons in your life, especially when you first stepped into a relationship with Jesus? You knew that when all you had was Jesus, you realized then that was all you needed was Jesus. And you never felt alone. You felt his presence, but maybe life began to pile up and you began to be beat up a little bit. And before that time happened, you felt so secure because God was your security. And then you hit seasons, and maybe you're there now, where you thought that God and your paycheck alone was your rock. Or you trusted God and your job, and you thought that alone was your security. Or God and my resources were my security. Or you trusted God and your business. But in that, there was worry and there was fear and at times insecurity. A few weeks ago, in fact, about a month and a half ago, we did a series, the EKG Financial Series. And we talked about you just can't trust in the uncertainty of things around us. God never changes, but things change. Listen to this verse. We read it about a month and a half ago. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for your enjoyment. Jesus in the garden, isolated, made a choice to be obedient to God. And there was a clarity of vision. And what's most important was to be obedient to God. What's most important? It's family. It's a relationship with Jesus. It's the connections that God gives to us. And most important, not religion, but a relationship with our loving Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ as we give Him the steering wheel of our lives. And Jesus said, I'll give you an abundant life, an eternal life. And Jesus said, I've come to take away the loneliness and the brokenness. That's the first great lesson. Second was not as long, but here's number two. Number two, the power of the cross. Power of isolation plus Jesus. Number two, the power of the cross. When Jesus died on the cross, His blood opened the door for His power, His love, and His forgiveness in your life. His presence to be with us. And Jesus at that moment shattered the infection of heartbrokenness, division, racism, loneliness, and all sin to give us eternal life. Listen to this verse, reference in your note sheet, 1 Peter. For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere silver or gold, which lose their value. Listen to this. It was the precious blood of Christ, the spotless Lamb of God. That's the price. You see, we infected ourselves with a virus called sin. And we separated ourselves from the love of God, and it broke God's heart. But God had a plan right from the very beginning. When we made a decision to infect ourselves, God had a plan, and God's plan was and is today for the power of His blood to cleanse us from the infection of sin. Listen to this. We are living in the light. As God is the light, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Oh, I love that. Listen to this. But now you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Listen to this, wait for it. It even gets better. We have the power because of the power in His blood over the enemy of your soul and mine. It says this in Revelation 12. They, meaning us, the church, have defeated him, the enemy, by the blood of the Lamb and by their testimony. There's power in His blood. Listen to this. Hebrews 9. With His own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, Jesus entered the most holy place once for all and secured our redemption forever. Just think, the Bible says, just think how much more the blood of Christ will purify our consciences from sinful deeds so that we can worship the living God. For by the power of the eternal Spirit, capital S, Christ offered Himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. His blood takes you and I into the very presence of our living Father, Heavenly Father, to never be alone. His presence with us forever. In the early church, in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, and it's really the Acts of the Holy Spirit, they faced persecution. You want to know why? Because the early church talked a lot about two things. They talked about the resurrection, and they talked about the blood of Jesus. It was a conversation. We see it in the New Testament. They talked about the cleansing power and the freedom that comes in the blood of Jesus. There were even false accusations because they talked about blood so much, the blood of Jesus, they faced false accusations. That kind of false stuff and mistruth, it's always been around. But they accused the early disciples of cannibalism. But they continued to rejoice in the Lamb of God. Listen to this verse, Ephesians 2. But now in Christ Jesus, you were once far away, but you've been brought near by the blood of Christ. Just before I pray with you, and I want to have a word of prayer with you, and I want to pray a prayer of blessing and then a very special prayer for you. I want you to listen once again. We sang it just a little bit ago. We sang this chorus, oh, the blood, oh, the precious blood of Jesus. If you're able, would you sing with us as we join once again and we sing what we sang just a few moments ago, the blood of Jesus. How true. Oh, the blood of Jesus. How precious is the blood of Jesus to cleanse, to heal, to set us free. Pray with me, would you? I want to pray for those of you that would say, you know what, I needed this. This was for me because I've really been feeling isolated and alone. And I'm a Jesus follower, but I feel a disconnect from others, from God. And your enemy and mine wants to do nothing more once again but instill fear and increase that isolation and loneliness. In part, that's a big part of what hell is. Being completely alone and absent from the presence of God. And you would say, I needed this. That's the first group I want to pray for. Here's the second group. As we're in prayer, I want to pray for those of you that would pray a prayer and say, I need Jesus in my life. For too long, I have held to, well, maybe God in the picture, maybe Jesus on the shelf, along with maybe a business, your savings account, 401k. Maybe your income or your paycheck or your job. And maybe your job has never been better for you, and we're thankful for that. But that never brings ultimate security. And I want to pray for those of you that would just pray a prayer and say, Jesus, I want to give you the steering wheel of my life. I need you in my life. So I'm going to say this prayer, and I want to invite every single one of you just in your mind and in your thinking, as best as you can, even if they're kids, and I know it can be so tough. I'm glad you're joining us online, but as best you can to just set aside all distractions and make this prayer your prayer just in your mind and in your thinking. If you choose to pray it out loud, join me in it. If not, it's okay. So just in your thinking to pray this prayer. You ready? Dear Jesus, I thank you that as we head into this Easter week, this great celebration of resurrection, may we never forget the road to Calvary. You overcame isolation and loneliness so that I would never have to be alone, and I thank you for that. I thank you that by your blood you conquered the infectious disease of loneliness, of heartbrokenness, of division, racism, every kind of evil and abuse, and you conquered it by your blood. And by your blood I am healed and I am cleansed. And I accept you now as my Savior. I need a Savior. And I accept you into my heart. And I invite you to come into my very soul and to take up residence in my life. And you will never leave me or forsake me. And I love you for that. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your blood. Thank you that even though I may be isolated now, the power of your presence with me never fails. Thank you, Jesus. You're alive today, and I give you praise, glory, and honor, and thanks in Jesus' name. And now everyone out loud said, amen. Everyone, thank you for joining us online. We love bringing the church to you. I can't wait to connect with you and to see some of your comments. If you have a question at all about the message or anything else, please let us know. Thank you for giving too. Thank you for making a difference, those of you who are able to. And no backdoor guilt if you don't have income coming in. Sometimes we just need to lean on Jesus. And when we do, we discover he's all we need. God bless you. I love you so much. We'll see you next weekend. Resurrection weekend. See you then. Bye-bye.